Good evening and welcome to a new edition of Harmonics. Today's guest is a legend, an East Bay legend, the bassist for Peter Wheaton, the Breadmen, none other than Bobby Birdwell. Bobby, hey. Welcome to my show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Man, you are absolutely, you know, seeing you, I have so many visual memories of you. Just welcome.
Thank you.
So what I'd like to do right now is tell me some, how did you actually, let's go this way. How did you get your first instrument and how did you get started in music?
You know, back in the early 60s, mm-hmm. I was up in Canada and I found a guitar. It was like $20 or something. So I bought it, cool guitar, played it for a little bit. It was about the time the Beatles hit. And of course the Beatles just knock you out.
Right.
For guys like us, right?
Yes. The
songs that were playing at the time were good stuff, but they weren't for us.
Right.
And so it just knocked me out. And so I really wanted to learn to play. And I wanted to play all the strings at once. That was my goal, is to play all the strings at once. So, you know, I took lessons, played for a while. I was maybe 13, maybe 12, something like that at the time. I had a friend, David Wheeler, still my best friend, and he and I used to play guitars together. He was much better than me, so I learned a lot from him. And so, you know, we played, kind of learned from each other a little bit, and so we decided to start a group. And so he and I looked for someone who could sing, because we couldn't sing, and looked for somebody who could play pretty good. And so he found Roger Kennedy. He was a friend of mine already. We had been friends for a long time. And Roger agreed to come in and play with us. So now we needed a drummer. We had no drummer. We didn't know a drummer. And a friend of ours, I don't know if you know Dave Houle, he's an old friend. He had a guy that he knew named Terry Rissman. And Terry wanted to play in a band, but he didn't have any drums. So he went to Mission High in Fremont. So he borrowed the drums from the Mission High marching band.
That's very
put
nice.
Together a trap kit, and that's what started our group. That was the four guys that became, at the time our band was called the Tarantelles.
And that evolved into?
What happened was David had to move. He moved down to Southern California. And so when he left the group, then he was our bass guitar player. And so that left us, you know, kind of lopsided. And so I decided that I would take up the bass at that time. Mm-hmm. And then we needed somebody to play rhythm guitar. So we decided that Roger would play rhythm instead of lead. He was playing lead at the time, so he could more concentrate on his singing. And then we brought in another guitar player, Barry Houck. And Barry wanted to bring in a keyboard player, so we brought in Chuck Tedford. And that was the five-piece band that became Peter Wheaton and Breadmen.
So when you became Peter Wheaton and Breadmen, because I know that was an outstanding band, were you playing original songs or were you still playing just covers and Beatles? What were you doing at that time? Because we're going to get into some of the great bands that you opened for. So were you guys just playing covers or?
Mostly covers. We had a few songs of our own. Not enough. If we had a lot of songs, you'd probably still be hearing us today.
There you go.
But, you know, we had a few that we did, mostly covers. We tried to do a lot of bluesy kind of stuff. We're kind of all into blues. We also did a lot of country and western. So we actually used to hire ourselves out as another band, the Showmen. If you remember the Showmen,
yes,
Larry,
yes.
Larry Camber's band.
Yes, yes, I do.
When they would be overbooked, because remember his mother was our manager at the time, okay. When they would be overbooked, they would book us in as the Showmen. And we would go in there and do country and western stuff.
Interesting. So Peter Wheat started going around. You guys actually started doing a lot of different shows in a lot of different areas. And then you started, let's talk about your experience with Roll Arena, Bill Corey.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Talk about Bill a little bit for us.
Well, you know, Bill's a legend. He's first of all, he's one of the nicest guys, way too nice to be a promoter. He's just a gem. I still enjoy talking to him today. Mm-hmm. You know, just a great guy. And I'll tell you, he hired us before we were Peter Wheat, when we were still just brand new, the five-piece band. And he hired us to open for the Turtles. And so that was our first ever Roll Arena show, because we were kind of a Fremont band. We kind of just played Fremont, Union City, and that area. So we opened for the Turtles, and that's where Barry Carlos saw us. And he was the original Peter Wheat band.
Right.
And they didn't want to really play much out anymore. What they wanted to do was manage a group. And so they hired us to be Peter Wheat. And so that's how we got the name, was through Barry Carlos. And it's a name that they had come up with before we came along. And so it wasn't much long after that. I'm saying just a couple of weeks after that show, we were doing shows as Peter Wheat.
So you mentioned another great person that was a local to all of us, Barry Carlos. What was Barry like? Another gentleman.
Yeah. Barry bailed me out of a lot of bad situations over the years. you know, still one of my best friends. I talk to him on a pretty regular basis. Just a great guy. He really is the reason that I'm sitting here today. You know, he's the guy that took us in, showed us how to do what we're doing, how to do it right, how to get that feeling on stage, having fun, being professional. He really schooled us a lot in that. So he's the reason that I'm sitting here today.
He's your mentor.
Absolutely.
So let's talk to you. So you guys did a couple shows. We did a lot of shows at Roll Arena. Them.
Yes.
Tell me about them and how that interaction went when you were a young kid and you're playing with the guys, you know, Van Morrison, that has actually the number one hits, Gloria, you know, you know, the whole Mystic Eyes.
Yes.
Baby Please Don't Go. How was that when you were with them?
Here is, or here they are, anyhow, they are them.
First of all, that was their very first show in the United States, was at the Roll Arena. And, you know, I was in awe because they were a big name at the time.
Yes, they were.
And Van Morrison is about my height. And so he really took a liking to me. And so we were pretty, you know, pretty friendly. This was just the first show. There's a picture of us out behind the Roll Arena they took that night. And I'm standing there. Van always wanted to stand by me because same height, you know. So he wanted to stand by me instead of those other tall guys. So he was standing next to me, and this girl that he had met that day, her name was Janet, was standing off to the side. And if you see the picture, she's staring at him, and she's looking right through me like I'm not even there.
Right.
And after that, we finished the show. We took the pictures and all that, and then we went out to dinner, and we went to a pizza place there in Hayward, and the whole, both groups together, had a really nice evening. He's a great guy. Mm-hmm. We did another show with him later, and this was down in the valley someplace, and he was a little bit, maybe, too much alcohol.
Okay.
And he was in a limousine, but it wasn't a limousine like you think today. It was like it was like an undertaker's limousine.
Okay.
It had, you know, a back seat, big stretch back seat,
then
two little jump seats.
Yeah.
And so they were using our equipment at the time. So he kind of got wild and maybe a little bit too happy. And he started kind of
Being aggressive?
Abusing his band members. Oh. And he kind of walked off the stage and he went back behind this theater we were in and he went and got in the limousine with Janet. And so I went out there to see what the heck's going on. I just wanted to see what the heck's going on. I went out there and he saw me and he said, come here. And I said, oh no, I don't want to get in there. I just saw what you did to your buds, you know. I don't want to get in the car with him. Right. He said, no, get in the car. So I got in the car with him. You know, I sat in the little jump seat in front. And, he was kind of almost incoherent. He was talking. And the police came and got him and hauled him away.
They took him to jail?
Yeah, I don't know they took him to jail. They took him away. I knew they took him away.
They took
yeah,
him
away. Yeah.
The Yardbirds.
Yes.
About that, Jimmy Page.
Yeah, I thought the first show we did with them was at the Roll Arena, but it really was at the Carousel Ballroom. Yeah, and they were actually, you know, pretty good bunch of guys. And their lead singer was a guy named Keith.
Yes, Keith Riff.
Very nice guy. Mm-hmm. Carried a pistol with him, and he wanted to show us all the pistol that he had. But, you know, that was back in the day when, you know, that wasn't frowned upon.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, unfortunately, he passed away not long after that. Yeah, what a great band. I mean, my goodness, what a
great band.
Oh, what a bunch of musicians those guys are.
They were totally. What's interesting, a little footnote on that, they actually, when they played at the Roll Arena, they actually stayed at another name that we both know, Kenny Sims. They stayed at Kenny Sims' house. Paige and Beck stayed over at his house.
Is that right?
Yeah, and I'd like to get Ken on the show and talk about that. But so another group that you opened up with was Paul Revere and the Raiders.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Good bunch of guys. Say Paul was a little older. He was maybe a little bit standoffish. Not a bad guy at all, but a little bit standoffish. The rest of the guys, just a fun bunch of guys. Mark Lindsay was probably one of the nicest guys you're ever going to meet. But very tall. Van Morrison wouldn't have liked him at all. But a good guy, really a good bunch of guys. We did a couple of shows with them, and they were always fun. You know, back in the day, because we were doing covers, we always made sure we didn't do their stuff. Oh. Never. You got to make sure you stayed away. We played with the Birds. We didn't do any Bird stuff. You know, played with them. We didn't do any of them stuff.
Right. So when you played with the Birds too, right?
Yes.
With the Birds, when they were doing Mr. Tambourine Man.
Yes.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me. I'm not sleepy and there ain't no place I'm going to.
How was Roger? Roger, I've heard Bill talk about it. Wasn't really a very pleasant. But how did they interact with you guys?
You know, I don't remember him really, especially. I've been to his concert since, mm-hmm. and I've seen him. Seemed like a good guy, but a very professional musician. Different than the rest of us who were kind of, you know, scatterbrained at the time. Mm-hmm. You know, they say if you remember the '60s, you weren't really there.
And that's why you don't remember me. That's why maybe Barry kind of got you out of trouble a couple of times. So you were going through there, and then all of a sudden a person came on the scene, Joyce Conright. Tell me about Joyce Conright with you and how does she influence your life and helped a lot of people, really.
Well, first of all, she was hired by Barry Carlos to do promotions for Peter Wheaton and Breadmen. And just a super nice lady. I loved her up to the day she passed. Mm-hmm. I was probably there right after you were there, maybe. Mm-hmm. Maybe a day or two before she passed.
Right.
Just a great lady, a lot of fun, a lot of pictures. She took a lot of pictures of us. And she told me that unfortunately she got in some financial trouble somewhere along the line and she sold the pictures. I don't know who got them. She didn't remember who bought them. Mm-hmm. But she took photocopies of all of them at the time. I don't know how many years ago it was. But she gave me all the photocopies that she took.
Excellent.
Of all, and there's a lot of pictures, a lot of that I don't remember.
So if anybody out there has those pictures,
yeah,
we'd like to see if you could give them to us. So that's just a ollie oxen free. If you could just give it to us, that'd be great to give to Bob. I think he'd really appreciate it. Tell us about the time with Janis Joplin. Tell us that ordeal when you were with Janis Joplin. Was that in Winland or was that?
No, it was actually at John Sweat High School.
Oh, she played in the high school over there.
Well, this was early on, and we had just had our 45 released. It was called Baby What's New. And so we were the headliner, and they were the opening act.
Down by my window, just looking out at the rain. By my window, just looking out at the rain.
Was Janis Joplin was the opening act, Big Brother. So, but she was known.
Amazing.
You know, she was known. You knew who she was.
Of course.
And so, you know, they opened for us. They used our stuff again. They used our equipment. And then, you know, we came on and did it. The dance promoter baked us a cake, a big sheet cake, and it said, congratulations, Peter Wheaton of Breadmen, and then in the middle it said, baby, what's new? It's a big sheet cake. And so we were gonna have like a little celebration backstage. So while we were backstage, you know, they got the cake out and they got the knife out to cut it, and Janis came over and she kind of stuck her finger in the cake, in the icing, and took some icing off the cake. And I didn't really think about it. I just kind of knocked her hand away. And I said, come on, man, we're going to eat that cake. And so, you know, it's a funny thing. I'll finish the story a second. But when we talked to Barry, Carlos, Barry Houck, Dale Radcliffe, who was playing keyboard at the time, everyone remembered the story. Everyone remembered the incident. We all remembered it differently. But anyway, I kind of knocked her hand away. She flung the frosting in my face. I kind of flung some back at her, and that's kind of the end of it. So we still call it the great Janis Joplin cake fight incident, but it really wasn't very much.
So how was Janis? I mean, obviously we all know Janis's life, that she was really like a shooting star, came quickly, and then she was gone, like Jimmy and a few others, Brian Jones too. But what was she really like in person? You actually rubbed shoulders with her. What was she really like?
You know,
or did you get a chance to talk to her a little bit besides flicking?
Besides the cake fight.
Yeah.
Not too much. Talked to her a little bit. She was pleasant, you know. Maybe because it was early on in her career. I know she got to be a little more boisterous later on.
Yes.
But you know, she wasn't really too bad. It was a pleasant evening.
Can you remember anything about Big Brother's performance that night?
Oh, they're a solid group.
So, in all of that time, how long did actually Peter Wheat actually existed? Because you guys came out, and then all of a sudden, what happened? You had a 45.
Roger had to get married. Chuck didn't want to really play anymore. He kind of went off on his own. We just kind of ran our course, you know, and so we started dropping out of the group kind of onesie at a time. And, you know, I think it was me and one other guy left of the original group. You know, we did the Peter Wheat Show Band there for a while.
Right.
And so that was a whole nother thing. It was kind of based on Tower of Power. You know, they had that sound. Mm-hmm. So we kind of wanted to try that.
With horns and stuff.
With horns.
Yes.
The difference is that the musicians we got were not rockers. And so we were trying to teach them how to be
rockers.
Right. They were musicians. And so they bring in charts, you know, and they'd say, this is how we're gonna play this. You know, four beats to a measure and all that. And that's not how we play rock.
That's not how we play
We play it by our gut.
Right there, feeling.
Exactly.
So in your time period, so that then was that your demise after the horn and the show band and all that?
Yeah, really. I mean, we kind of went back and did a few shows again as the old Peter Wheat, but it really wasn't the same.
So let's go a little bit different before we revisit another topic in your life. Your array of musical instruments. I once seen a picture that you sent out. What is your instrumentation now? You got a very nice collection of guitars and basses, but tell me, what What do you have? What is your favorite instrument? How many instruments do you actually have?
I probably have guitars, probably a dozen. Mm-hmm. I have in my home two pianos and a keyboard. Mm-hmm. And I got a violin and I got a mandolin, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Right.
But guitar-wise, I mostly play acoustic now. I don't play bass much. I have a really, really nice P bass, you know, Fender P bass. Back in the day, I was playing a jazz bass. I like the P bass a little bit better. But, and I still have it. I love it. Great guitar.
Do you still have your original bass with you?
No. No, I don't have it. I play through a dual Showman amp.
Still good sound.
Still a great sound.
Yeah.
You know, it's tubes.
Oh, yeah. It's warm.
And, but I also have a basement amp. And then I've got I probably got a half a dozen amps, you know.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Let's talk about a situation that just happened in your life, was very beautiful. You played an acoustic number, a Bob Dylan number, to your son who got married to your daughter-in-law.
Right.
That was a very touching. Tell me about that. And how did that all develop, and you know, that you got to sing for them?
Well, I still play a lot, mm-hmm. Especially for family.
Yes.
So my daughter-in-law, her name is Gina Birdwell now.
Excellent.
She heard a song and she really liked it. And when they were getting married, they were planning their wedding, and they came to me and they said, "Would you do a song? Just one song during the ceremony?" And I was honored.
Of course.
So I said, "Yes, absolutely. What song do you want?" And they named "You Ain't Going Nowhere" by Bob Dylan. And so I put the song together for them, changed the lyrics just a teeny little bit, just to honor her as a bride.
It was touching.
I thought it was great.
I really like that. So let's talk, you're playing music. Let's talk about your other love that you have, and that's raising pugs. Tell us about what that is and how that has all developed in your life.
Well, it started about 20 years ago, and we got our first pug. We weren't really planning on showing or anything like that. We just wanted a pet. But we found a dog that a lady said, you know, this is really, really a nice dog. I'd like it to be shown. We said, yeah, maybe we will. And we did. We started showing it, and it's one of those things, it just consumes you. And so now my wife and I, we raise the dogs, we breed them, we raise them, we show them, and we both judge them.
That's a fabulous story. And you said, so you breed them, you send them out anywhere? You send them out to different places?
You know, we don't breed a lot. We don't breed very often, but we think we breed some pretty good dogs.
Tell about the dog that went first class.
We have a dog that we sold to a lady in Russia, and she lives outside of Moscow. So the dog flew from Los Angeles to Moscow first class. We won't ship a dog in baggage. Mm-hmm. We only ship a dog inside the airplane. And so someone has to fly with the dog. And so we sent a couple of dogs, well, we sent three dogs to Europe just 2 years ago.
Wow.
And so they all went over with people, you know, taking them over.
Taking them over.
Yeah.
Two final questions. What was your biggest influence in music?
You know, there never was a time in my childhood when there wasn't guitars and music being played in my house. You know, my dad played, my cousins played, my uncles played. Everybody played music. And so it was always there, and country western was a big influence, not because I wanted it, because I really wasn't into country western. You know, as a kid, I wanted rock and roll, but my dad had control of the radio. There was one radio in the house, he controlled it. So I got a lot of country western. And now it kind of got ingrained in me, and I really enjoy it now. For bass, you know, there's John Entwistle, and then everybody else.
That's a great choice.
But I really, really think that Rocco, Tower Powers Rocco, is a fabulous bass player.
Most definitely.
I would love to sit with him anytime.
Oh, Rocco, you just got a great plug. Yes, Rocco is one of the greatest.
Rocco's
yes.
An old friend.
Yes, he is. So the last question is, what is happening to Bob Birdwell now? And you have a gift coming. You have a grandson getting ready to be born.
Yes.
And what is Bob seeing in the future?
Well, I've been working, this is my 50th year kind of doing the same thing I've always done.
Okay.
Building heavy duty motor vehicles. I've done it for 50 years. I've been with my current company 36 years, day after tomorrow. And so I'm looking to go about a couple of more years and then I'm gonna retire.
Good for you.
My plan is to retire. Our grandson should be born this summer.
God bless him, and you.
Yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. And so by the time I retire, he's gonna be ready to go exploring with Grandpa.
Excellent.
I can't wait.
I can't wait to actually congratulate you when you actually have your grandson. Well, it's been great having you on. Time does fly. And I want to give a shout out. Bob Birdwell is a rock and roll gentleman. He's a legend, East Bay legend. He's in three books that are right now in the Hall of Fame. The San Francisco Bay Area, East Bay Garage Bands. It's wonderful to have him on my show. I hope to have him again. But God bless you, and I will see you again. But as tradition, we actually look into the camera, and we actually blow a kiss to all our fans. You can say whatever you want, but I usually say peace and love to y'all. God bless you.
God bless.